Do you think Kenya can do without loans from China? That's what we're asking you this morning. Of course, this will be the basis of our conversation from 7 to 7.30 when we do weekend review. We are asking you, do you think Kenya can honestly do without the loans from China? Let me just sample a bit of your feedback. So far, 79% of you say yes and 21% say no. 96 of you have voted. There's still about 2 hours, 2 minutes left for you to get in your comments as well. But let me read one or two. Norbert, you say, we can do without those loans from China or wherever. A lot of money is lost through corruption. We must seal all the loopholes and recover all the stolen money. More loans only leads to more suffering to Wanjiku. All right? And Nelly, you say, Kenya, we got a lot of resources, but it's only that we are being brainwashed by cheap things from abroad. We export our raw materials, we later buy them expensively. We've got to raise our antenna much higher. All right, I hear you. 60% of loans goes to top government officials through corruption. That's another comment. One last one before we dive into press review. Wanjiru, you say, what we need to do is pay all their debts and be done with them. It won't matter if we will be bankrupt. We will still rise up. Okay, so your points are valid, and that's our Twitter poll question this morning. Do you think Kenya can do without loans from China? Again, that will be the basis of our conversation later on the show during weekend review. This is my panel this morning. On my far, far left, I have Honorable Joe Mutambo, the former Member of Parliament for Mwingi Central. At the center, I have James Mamboleo. He is an advocate, the legal minds on the panel, and Mark Bichachi is sitting closer to me. He's a political analyst. Gentlemen, it's always a pleasure to have you here with us this morning. The Standard newspaper this morning, demolitions on grabbed airport land set to start. We have 9 days until the period before the inaugural flight from JKIA to New York, and 220 acres. That's the size of land the Kenya Airports Authority wants to reclaim. And 50 is the number of warehouses that will be pulled down within 10 days. And that specific story can be found on page 6 of the newspaper this morning. Gentlemen, I have to ask, and perhaps I'll begin with Mheshimiwa on this specific story. If you look at what's happening right now with the demolitions, we saw a lot of these buildings come down, Nakumat UK, Taj Mall, a lot of them, the South End Mall in Langata. Right now in question is a Western Hotel owned by the DP along Langata Road. But his lawyer, Ahmed Nasir, who has come out and said, but my client has the proper documentation, leads me to then ask the next question. Didn't all these other people whose assets have come down not have, again, the right documentation? So is Sunny being selective on what buildings to bring down?
First and foremost, I don't believe in demolition. Because I am an investor in this country. And before I put my money, I follow the due process. The big question would be, what is the legal document in Kenya? Then somebody will come and demolish you tomorrow and say you are not a Kenyan. You will be demolished tomorrow, and you are told you are not Kenyan. What do I mean? Before an investor puts in their money, they go through a due process. There is no building which stands without, number one, being given a title deed. Mm-hmm. That title deed comes from the government office. Mm-hmm. Which government? Ugandan government or Kenyan government? What we need to re-audit is how are we issuing title deeds to the people of either Kenya or any other investor who want to invest in Kenya. That is number one. Number two, before that building goes up, the town planner is there. They have seen it. Before that building goes up, NEMA has seen it. So these people, they have acquired all the documentation. I don't care whether you have acquired them illegally or, I mean, using your corruption means or not. The moment you get that certificate, for you to come and revoke it, is a different story.
Right.
Right? So I don't believe in demolition. I believe in doing things in the right way. If a land is a road reserve, why
for God's sake, issue a title deed. And before I go to the developer, I will go to the person who issued that title deed.
So for, or let's say now a lot of these have already been built, then what solution would you table if you're not for demolition?
I think to me, take for example, UK. Nakomati UK. It's been there since when? It's been there since when? Is it today we are waking up and saying this building is on a road reserve? Did we compensate the owner? Did the owner recover his investment? Then we are crying we are poor? That is the question we are asking ourselves. What kind of investment are we wasting in demolition? I don't believe in it. Sorry, I'm not waiting to, but other means need to be followed. Why are we getting permissions? Because the same, there's no Kenyatta's government and the Moi's government and the Uhuru's government. They are all the same. It's a government, it's a government. And the moment you own a title deed, it is your valid document. You get it from the government. Unless now we are told this country, tomorrow somebody will come and reclaim it and say it is Somali. Mm-hmm. That is when we will wake up and understand the meaning of demolition. But today we are putting a lot of politics because I don't like my good lawyer here. I'll say he has built in a riparian land and he must quit. Ask yourself, why did you give him that permission to build?
All right, so Mamboleo, do you think that the law is being selective?
Not at all. This is where I want to create broad daylight between myself and my good friend John Mutambu here. There is a constitution, a social contract that we have given unto ourselves. Article 62 categorizes land into public land, private land, and community land. Mm-hmm. Now, there is a National Land Act, a National Land Commission Act, which establishes the National Land Commission, which was tasked with the responsibility of reviewing all parcels of land with very clear intentions. The first one being to identify any land which was public land, which was alienated in a wrong manner, all right? I want to tell you this, and I want to make it clear to Kenyans. Let us not pretend that these big shots who have built on public land did not know that it was public land. What they did is this. They went to corrupt land officials. They went to corrupt government officials and colluded and got titles in a way that they understand and knew at the time to be wrong, mm-hmm. okay, and illegal. And so they can now not waive those pieces of title and say, you know, we had the permissions to build. There is a process by which a title is given. If you go through the process, you will find that someone cut a corner at some point and allocated riparian reserves. They gave away land which was supposed to be for playgrounds, beaches. They gave away land that was supposed to be for green parks and for recruitment parks and so on. And this is the land on which private developers have now built, and they are claiming that they have title on, for which they do not want demolished. Mm-hmm. This is what we need to say very quickly. The process of getting the title is as good as the title itself. If the process is wrong, if the process is illegal, if it is fraudulent, then the end result is actually illegal. And so where, in actual fact, someone has used improper process, fraudulent process, and obtained a title on which they have now built, those ones cannot be entertained. But I want to give hope to those who got the titles correctly, because this is the law. If you get your title properly and someone down the line begins to claim that, you know, your land sits on a riparian reserve or something else, you come to the relevant authorities and show that this is how I got this title. And the law says everyone who has gotten title properly, without using other means like corruption and so on, can sue the government of the Republic of Kenya and get compensation. So let us not make noise. Let us not make noise here. Any person who has not been compensated, including the UK, they know that the process by which they obtained those titles is probably wrong.
All right, so on that same level, let me bring in Bichachi. Bichachi, we've talked, Mamboleo has very well put in line the agencies that are involved, the National Land Commission, NEMA, etc. Shouldn't the president be not working to prosecute the individuals behind it, because tomorrow, 10 years from now, we will still be having this conversation of demolitions happening in Nairobi if we do not fix the core problem right here, which is obtaining those letters. And they come from NEMA and the other agencies like the National Land Commission.
When we used to watch Vioja Mahakamani many, many years ago, the judge used to say, iwe na ili iwe funzo kwa wengine wenye tabia kama hii, and then would pass a harsh sentence. The president in turn promised us that if his own brother was caught in corruption, that his brother should face the full force of the law. The president then went ahead to tell us on national TV that he has lost friends. So as far as I am concerned, whether these friends are near Wilson Airport or near JKIA, whatever it is they own, he should apply the law equally. And that being said, it also means that the person who obtained the title deed fraudulently, and the person who gave the title deed fraudulently, and the person who gave the NEMA license to build fraudulently, and the person, the planner, the urban planner who allowed for that building to go up fraudulently, all of them should be talking to us from the grills of a jail cell. And that is what Kenya should come to. The reason Kenya needs to come to this is without that, we will not have a semblance of law and order. The kind of mercy that Jomo Tambo is trying to ask Kenyans to give people who have robbed, pillaged, murdered, and raped Kenyans to get those buildings is unfair. Because where is the justice that a lady who is so broke that she wants to sell her own blood so she can keep her two children alive is today in prison, while someone who stole money from our hospitals, someone who stole land from an airport so that now our planes can't land safely, that person who's putting our lives in danger every day is walking scot-free? And this is the same kind of hubris that we tolerated with the person who had a bus that was 3 months insurance expired, that was overloaded, it was over speeding, and the man driving it was over age, and we watched it and we only complained after 55 people died. Mr. President, let us not wait for floods to kill our people because we built on riparian land. Let us not wait for aeroplanes to land on top of people working in warehouses for us to fix this problem. Friend or foe, including Joe Mutambo's own house, if he has one, it must be destroyed. And I'm saying that in front of the public so that Kenyans should know justice should be applied without fear or favor. And I say that knowing that Joe Mutambo is my good friend. But if you have land, my friend, that is, you've built on riparian, tunavunja.
Speaking of which, Honorable Mutambo.
I wish I had one.
You wish you had one.
I don't have.
Honorable Mutambo, I have to ask you, yes. Why is it that right now when we have 9 days to the inaugural flight between Nairobi and New York, 9 days, 50 warehouses, why is it right now that the Kenya Airports Authority is coming out to say that this land belongs to us? Why now, all these years down the line? Does it show lack of planning by the Kenya Civil Authority?
You know, my problem is right there. Why are we treating flights to UK more special than a flight going to Germany?
Well, he was saying what, it's because of safety.
That's what bites me, that's what disturbs me. Why are we raising a red flag because of US? That means somebody somewhere is micromanaging Bichache and my good friend here. And I've had him trying to solicit for some work. Because he said if there's anybody who has built somewhere, to look for a lawyer, and he's one. Unfortunately, I'm not. What I'm seeing from him is trying to get some job. My point is not about who has built where. And he has elaborated very clearly that there's a public land and private land and a government land. At what point did this land become public? That's a question we need to ask. All land, including what you call public, belongs to the government. It is for the public of Kenya. Then it was divided into categories. And it is people who divided it into categories. And if certain people sit down and divide it into categories and say, this is a public or this is a private land, so be it. It is not God who says, this is a private, this is a public, this is government land. This
It is us Kenyans. We use our land the way we deem right to use it.
Mm-hmm.
And if at one point people seated somewhere, like my good lawyer here, and made a decision that land can be utilized in this manner, so be it. There is no way we are going to say, no. It was that. If a law has been passed, and if it was done legally, I'm talking about the law.
Right.
If it was done legally.
Right.
I would not say somebody to go and build in a school. If that land was earmarked to be a school, and is definitely a school, and you build in that school, then there is a problem. There is a problem. I am not saying that people should grab land.
Mm.
Hell no. What we are doing, we are raising eyebrows because somebody somewhere is macromanaging our country. Somebody somewhere has raised a red flag. And we have readily put a question. Why are we raising this question today? And we've been flying all over the world, and we have never heard that this person has built this godown near the airport, so it needs to come. And for your information, I am a pilot. All right? And we know the laws and the procedures to follow, to be followed at the airport. It is us Kenyans who make a lot of hullabaloo about the building. And we have seen airports with many buildings built around them, and planes still do land.
All right.
Yes, there are some precaution measures which are put.
Gentlemen, because
I want to take you to let me take you to Dubai,
okay,
where the airport is built. Actually, on the other side, you land on top of a road hunter.
Okay, so gentlemen, so because
that
of time.
Godown cannot be built near the airport.
Right. Mambolea, I wanted to come to you, but because of time, we need to move on from this specific topic. I want us to tackle one more.
Yes.
The Rio Olympic 2016 scandal. 55 million Kenyan shillings at the heart of it. And from that 55 million, 2.4 million was used on plane tickets.
Yes.
Mambolea, the latest that we have on this specific one is that Kipchoge has now become a state witness.
Yes.
But explain to me, talk to Kenyans, how is it that, or rather, what constitutes for someone to move from a suspect to a state witness and vice versa?
There are many ways in which you can be a witness. One of them is if you are claiming, and it can be shown that you are actually not guilty of the offense, and you are saying, I was in this process, but of course it was not me. It was people like my good friend Joe Mutambu who did this offense. Okay, so it was not me, and I'm willing to give testimony against him. The second way you can become a state witness is this. You can say, I was with Joe Mutambu. Though I was with Joe Mutambu in a process in which he is the one who stole the money, he only gave me a little. So this is what I'm going to do. I am going to do what they call a plea bargaining deal, all right, in which instead of charging me for this big offense with which Joe Mutambu is being charged, I can be charged for a lesser offense or something like that. This happens all the time. It happens in every jurisdiction across the world. And the only problem that would raise is Kipchoge Keino had better be sure about what he's doing, because otherwise he could get into a scenario in which he has thrown his friend Wario under the bus, and then the likelihood is that later...
Is the reversible possible, where you move from a witness, a state witness, then to a suspect?
Yes, there's absolutely no telling that along the way, if Wario and the others did these things together with Kipchoge Keino, as they go to trial, they might also meet Jesus along the way and say, look, it was not just us, but Kipchoge was with us all the time. So that they do a cross representation on which now Kipchoge Keino will also be brought on book. In fact, in my view, what the DPP should be doing is assessing and looking at evidence. And they don't have a reason of giving Kipchoge Keino freedom when they are able to prove that he was actually part of the process of stealing funds from the public. They should net all those people, including Kipchoge Keino, if he was involved. I am just imagining that probably they have assessed the evidence and they have realized that as far as they can find, Kipchoge Keino was not part of it. Otherwise, there is no way that they are going to tell us that, you know, we did this because Kipchoge Keino has decided to be our witness and he did not do anything.
All right, that's right there means that we need to go on break. We need to release our KTN home viewers for Life and Style. But